baby beard.
All right, I'm a delivery boy.
Who is Hermes planning on killing?
I think we should let the orphans run free.
You've redeemed funds.
Yeah, exactly. You haven't. He's just an old guy.
Can we talk about evil Lincoln?
Oh, of course.
No, this art needs to be sent. That's not the voice at all.
That's lobster tain.
Let's make it the
Look,
Christmas.
Let me ask you this.
He was just about to agree with you.
Wow. Shut up and take my podcast.
I thought you said you weren't doing Cockney.
I wasn't doing Cockney. That was more like Boston. Like, aye!
It was a it was a swerve right back into Cockney.
Yeah. It was a different Cockney though.
Yeah,
because
we
jumped the other. Oh!
But it was Michael Caine. Michael Caine.
I told you to just blow the bloody doors off.
Well, bees.
Interesting. Yeah,
bees.
Because
he's in a movie
with a giant bee.
Well, not giant bees, but lots of bees. African bees.
Oh, there's also
called the swarm.
And in the Journey to the Center of the Earth as well, he's in that and he rides on the back of a giant bee.
There you go.
It's on a giant thing.
Excellent choice of voice. Well done.
Thank you.
So, guys, this is the podcast about Futurama. This is Shut Up and Take My Podcast. Mm-hmm. The Futurama podcast that pits episode against episode in bloody, glorious, waspy, gauntlet battle.
They're bees.
For your entertainment. And I am joined here by bee number one, Phil.
It was all a dream.
By bee number five, Josh.
Listener, I just need you to wake up.
And we're joined by Sean.
Welcome to the episode I've been waiting for since we began this podcast.
Oh, wow. Really? That's hype.
I have a bit of love. I love.
I have a love. My first note I wrote was, The Sting. I think this is the best episode, ? And then I wrote after it, Yes.
So, ladies and gentlemen, episode. We are up to season 4, episode 12 of The Sting!
The Sting!
Which is a reference to what?
A Paul Newman movie called The Sting.
The Sting! What year was it?
1982.
1978.
The winner is Phil. It was 1973, so you were the closest.
I was still a ways off.
I totally knew that without looking it up. Absolutely.
I definitely knew it was pre-80s.
Yes. I didn't know it was a movie, so I know the title, just didn't know what movie it was. Yeah.
So the director for this episode was Brian Beasley. I mean Sheasley. back from The Root of All Evil.
Oh, good episode.
Yeah. This is...
The Root of All Evil is the paper one.
Yes.
I was thinking of Insane in the Mainframe.
Ah, which is also one of my favourites.
Yes. Route and...
Cheesy's got a good set of episodes.
Yes. Well, this is his final episode.
Oh.
And what an episode to end on.
His 10th episode.
Number 10 is the best.
Wow.
So, Brian Sheasley, one of the latest credits he has been credited for, which I can only find on one website, and it's the Emmy's website.
So you know it's legit. It was one
Should
website.
Be legit. And it's Camp WWE. So if you don't know that, it was WWE, the wrestling organization.
Yes.
It was their attempt to make a South Park-esque kind of TV series because they're very much PG. Mm-hmm. Nowadays, they're geared towards a more family-friendly audience.
Yeah,
but to appease the older generation, they tried to make this kind of South Park style where it's kid versions of the wrestlers in a camp.
Oh, I know this.
I thought when you said camp, WWE, it was going to be like a carry-on WWE.
Yeah.
Let's do wrestling.
Well,
one of
the creators or one of the people involved in the process was Seth Green. So that's to give you an idea.
Oh.
But Brian Sheasley apparently was also a director for this. But I can only find it on the Emmy knob. Emmy knobs. Website.
You don't want to be looking at the Emmy's knob too.
So it's not even on his IMDb page.
No. Okay. So unclear. But
so
most likely,
expunged it from his IMDb page.
Might be a Alan Smitty sort of situation.
Now the writer for this episode is Patrick M. Verone, from a Leela of her own.
Oh, good episode.
And Patrick M. Verone is going to be returning this year because he's the co-executive producer for Disenchantment. Which is the Matt Groening series that's going to be coming in August. Which, just as a little precursor for you listeners here, we will be incorporating Disenchantment as a side mission.
Sweet. I look
cool. We're not doing like a separate show on it because that'd be pretty cool too.
We could do that.
Yeah.
We could do that as well.
I do.
Yeah.
A bit of...
I,
bit,
Enchantment in the Disenchantment.
Get on the ground floor, you know.
I haven't seen nothing about that. I'm not watching anything because I'm super excited to watch the first episode.
Yeah, just, yeah.
I've read like a one-liner for it, but I haven't seen the trailer. I've seen one clip and that's it.
I don't really know much about it at all.
I've seen a frame of the animation. Yeah. I'm like, okay, cool, it's Matt Groening animation, but I'm excited to see it.
Yeah. All I know is Simpson was present, Futurama was future, and Disenchantment is the past.
Mm. So it's Pastorama.
Yes, it is Pastorama.
It's Pastorama.
And also just as a little... Okay, I'm going to do two things because I ruined my own format last week. And I didn't give you the air date for when No Fan Has Gone Before, so just for my purposes, that was April 2nd, 2002. Mm-hmm. And for this episode, it's June the 1st, 2003.
Wow.
We're catching up. Yeah. Not really, but...
Introducing the killer bees slash wasps, depending on which episode we're...
Yes, because in the... Yeah. So I remember when they originally get hired, he has a paper envelope that says...
Contents of
space wasp's stomach.
Yes.
Yes.
So either a different crew was killed by space wasps.
Which is very true. It's
very possible, isn't
it?
That he has lost a crew to both space wasps and space bees.
Yeah.
Or the writers just retconned it.
The writers tried so hard to retrofit it to space wasps, but they can't because...
Yeah. Honey.
Honey.
Yeah.
Honey.
there is another thing, speaking of retconning, future hint, the bees do return in a later episode, a Kwanzaa-based episode.
Right.
Where they return, but the bees can suddenly talk at that point.
Of course.
English.
They probably talk. Right. They probably talk in this. They just choose not to.
Yeah, yes. I mean...
speak in their native... If you're in their land, you speak in their language.
And there's one man here who can speak our language and let us know what happened. Phil!
Oh.
What happened in this episode?
It's a little hard to plot this episode because of the big reveal at the end. So, on the surface, there's a story about how Fry dies while the crew attempt to get some precious space honey.
Mm.
And Leela's quest to bring him back from the dead when she keeps experiencing Fry in her dreams. Mm-hmm. Big spoiler. I don't think we do spoilers on this program. Yeah. That.
Wait. 3, 2, 1.
Spoilers.
Yeah. Now you can go.
Fry is not dead, and Leela has been in a coma for the whole time from the bee's sting, and Fry never left her side and has been talking to her during her coma the whole time.
For two weeks.
For 2 weeks. Gorgeous. Yeah.
Now...
wouldn't stop talking like a parrot of the sea he was.
Yes.
Ladies and gentlemen, what do we think? But before I ask what we think, let me tell you what a lot of other people thought.
Oh! Okay,
this is a new segment.
So, it hits number 24 on Josh's favorite reputable source, IGN.
See, this is why IGN's wrong. This is better than the previous episode.
So number 24 on their top 25 Futurama episodes. It was nominated for an Annie for Outstanding Writing in an Animated Television Production. Nominated for an Emmy for Outstanding Animated Program.
Good.
Oh yeah, very quickly. So for the Annie, they lost to Three Gays of the Condor. The Simpsons episode that we talked about.
Oh, the Weird Al one. No, yeah. This is better.
For the Emmy, they lost to Samurai Jack.
Which is, I've heard very good things
it's
about.
It's a beautiful series.
I haven't watched
series.
That in ages. It's a great show.
Never seen it at all, so.
It's a great
I've
show.
I've heard good things.
They were nominated for the Writers Guild of America for Best Television Writing, and they lost to, oh God, my writing, The Dad Who Knew Too Little, which was a Simpsons episode.
Which one was that one?
No clue.
I'm going to Google it while you run down.
It was number 8 on Comedy Central's Futurama Fanorama Marathon.
Good. Deserves to be in the top 10.
It was number 48 on Futon Critics' Top 50 Television Episodes of 2003. So across the entire...
Just of that year?
Yes.
I think it should be higher. I mean, I don't know. My knowledge of all animated episodes from 2003 is a little patchy.
Oh, no. Not animated. Just television episodes in general.
Okay.
And it's one of Matt Groening's favourite hand-picked episodes.
Yeah.
To clarify, The Dad That Knew Too Little is the episode where Homer hires a private investigator to spy on Lisa so that he can know more about her, and then he holds things hostage and tries to betray her.
Yeah. That's got my line of, don't worry, Mr. Simpson. I can be very persuasive. Leave town!
No.
Oh, come on!
No.
Oh, you're mean. So what do we think, though?
Oh, I had a ball in this episode. It's great.
I think this is the best episode? Question mark, answer yes.
Yes. Well, it has a lot of great elements. It has great comedy. It has
emotional resonancy through the roof.
Yeah, like a wonderful depiction of the relationship between Fry and Leela, without getting too far into the will they won't they. It's just how good friends they are and how much they support and depend upon each other.
More than just friends at this point, they are like soul bound.
Yeah,
to the degree that Leela will gladly go into an eternal sleep so that she can be with Fry.
Well, there's also a really strong element of guilt in it as well. Yeah. It's not just because of their relationship.
Yeah.
It's because she feels
directly responsible
for
there,
much.
There are three things that this episode deals with, and I love these three things that they deal with, and that's guilt, its loss, and its madness.
Yeah, yeah. It's got really strong themes. The other thing I wanted to quickly say in my first impressions is that the animation in this episode is so good.
So good.
Using the layered dream idea means they get a lot of license. But even before they even go into that, the realization of the hive is so cool. And the chase scene,
it's gorgeous.
When they're fleeing the hive and Fry has got his upside down boosters on, he's bashing into the walls.
Once again, good animation. Great. When they show Fry, you can already see that his boosters are upside down.
Yeah. Josh has never been more gleeful than in that chase scene.
Yeah, I loved it.
I literally said to them, like, this bit of animation is going to be amazing, and it's when the Queen Bee tries to stab into the Planet Express ship and Bender's on it, and there's something so satisfying about watching him jitter around, be like, I'm back, baby, and he's thrown off.
Also, this episode has probably the best sound design that I have heard through Futurama. The use of score, the use of, especially when we come into the hive.
Yep.
Just like you can just get that overwhelming sound of the bees and the score underneath and the tension that comes through.
There is also there is the standard Star Wars joke that comes out of it as well, of one fighter pilot spins off and hits something and explodes.
Yeah, the bee has to explode for no reason.
Also, Nibbler really gets shit on in this episode.
Oh my god.
Well. Every time Leela wakes up when Nibbler's there, he just slams against the wall.
Protector of the universe slammed against the wall three times.
That's why you don't wipe people's memory. So that they can give you some goddamn respect.
Respect? At this point, Nibbler just making some incorrect decisions about how he goes about his favourite people.
One of my favourite things in movies or television shows or books is portraying madness in a really interesting and convincing way. And this madness is done so simply by just having some voices switch to begin with. You have some voices switch and you have Leela just losing track of time or losing track of something. And then even to that musical number, which is the payoff of oh, she's going down the rabbit hole. I'm like, that is just so good.
And we haven't had a musical number in a long time, I feel like. I can't remember the last time we had
Beck?
Beck?
That's a long time.
Yeah. And before that was probably Hermes requisitioning his groove back.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's also probably the reason why
we're missing one, but yeah.
Yeah, I think there's another one in there.
Yeah.
But Bender can't sing possibly because of Beck. Because
of Beck, it's like a nice little bit of... There is continuity all through this episode.
There's a ton of callbacks and stuff. Yeah,
and this
is
the question. This is the part that I like is... speaking of madness, there's the shot that's like... I think it works even better when you realize that this is all a dream. Is Bender's just on fire? And they all run in and
never
just like,
mentioned. Never mentioned again.
And then
great.
You start looking at it, and it's just this is Leela's subconscious just moving things into place. And possibly continuity, but also possibly just Leela's mind just desperately trying to clutch to things to make it all make sense.
It might be just normal for her to see Bender on fire. It just happens a lot.
I like looking at the things that Leela keeps as memories of Fry.
Mm.
Like the little oil can that he uses to when he believes he's a robot from Insane in the Mainframe. Yes. He's got the honey back from season one, the honey spoon.
The commemorative spoon of him being
My Three Sons.
Yeah.
Yep.
Which is a great episode. There's a Also, there was... What was it?
There's all his previous lovers at his funeral.
Yes. And the radiator from the radiator planet.
We finally get to see the radiator.
That was great.
What a radiator.
There was a lot of, reappearances. Even, I really appreciate the farewell from the world of tomorrow. Like, that... Instead of, the welcome to the world! It's, the flip side of that. I'm like, oh, Fry might actually be dead.
Was that honestly his best take? Because I feel like he goes, I was like, what?
Question.
Yes.
Scruffy.
Yes.
Scottish?
Yes. Yeah.
Does he play bagpipes?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
And he's got the kill.
Literally, you don't have to be Scottish.
No, you don't have to. That's
but
my question.
He could very well be
does
Scottish.
Does he have some...
He doesn't have a Scottish accent.
No, he does not.
There's also a lot of... I think everyone that's significant to Fry in some regard is at that funeral. There are two people from the My Three Sons planet.
Michelle.
There's
there.
Signals.
Gunter.
There's Signals that he helps. There's Gunter. There's two elves from
Neptune.
Yep. There was a couple of other people there as well where it's like, oh, these people have all been significant.
Snoo Snoo Lady.
Amazonia.
Amazonia.
Yeah.
The only person that believes that Fry is good in bed.
Yes. Everyone, they don't say he's awful. He's
all right.
And my favourite sad callback in that scene, don't worry, Leela. He's walking on sunshine. Right in the fields.
Seymour is there as well, propped up against his coffin.
Oh, no!
Wait, what? Really?
Did you not see that?
Oh!
Like, right at the beginning when they're all paying their respects, you see Seymour placed against it. Which is just, again, a nice little...
Two things that I love from the funeral scene. Number one, Farnsworth has changed into a black lab coat.
Yep, with a blue tie.
Yep. And that when they close the casket, the stinger that was still there just goes right into him.
There are still some really...
right through him.
They managed to do some really tasteful jokes in this as well. Like Leela being mournful and Francis being like, no. I'm lying to make her feel better.
So on taste and jokes.
Yes.
Can we mention the one particular joke that comes when they enter the beehive?
Oh, yeah, that is a joke and a half.
The edgiest potential joke of Futurama.
What would that be, Sean?
Oh, the domestic violence joke?
Yes.
What was it? It was...
Bees communicate by dancing. It's like, oh, just like my parents. No, wait, that was hitting.
Yes.
It's like, not
what you see from the flashbacks of his parents?
No.
But
they hit one another?
View?
No.
Of... the parents now?
Yeah, it's pretty dark, isn't it?
I think that joke may have been originally a sex joke, but then they were like, the censors
are like... I don't
think
that's any better.
That's the thing. I think the censors may have said, no, you can't have a sex joke in there.
But
domestic violence. Let's have a DV joke.
So it's kind of maybe it was a middle finger to them being like, fine, it's a domestic abuse joke.
It also gives you much more insight into Fry and Yancey's relationship and maybe why they were as antagonistic as they were to each other.
It was a different time.
It was a very different time. I'm a huge fan of Bender dancing in this episode as well. Just to communicate.
With his subtitles? Yeah. There's the funny funeral, which is not something to say very often.
It links
to one of the things I really like. Another little aspect of this episode I really like is some of the design work. So, yeah, you have the black lab coat. I also made note of Bender's veil he has over his eyes, which is very nice. And then also there's the Bender's golf outfit in the opening
with
scene.
With the golf hat
and his plus fours he's wearing and the Argyle pattern.
Is
and
his antenna going through the hat?
Yeah.
I guess so.
Yeah, and then the plug-in so that he can dive into the...
Bender function.
The space suits are great as well. They're really retro-futuristic. Mm. I really like the design. It's just a little thing that you could just sort of miss... but it's got great attention to detail. I love the suits that they wear in the hive. Really cool.
So another story from this episode is you got a little giggle out of when Leela is crying and she grabs a tissue, she tears it in half.
Because she only needs one tissue, half tissue, right?
That's the assumption. That's not why they put it in.
Why?
It's an in-joke about David X. Cohen. So there's a point early on in the writing of Futurama where David X. Cohen was quite sick, but to preserve tissues, because he didn't want to have to keep buying them and keep using them, he just tore them in half and would use half
their
time.
That's awesome.
All right. So it's just a callback to David no reason.
I guess that they also were like, well, it also makes sense for Leela because she has one eye. So it works on both levels.
Well, they chatted about it in the commentary. They're like, no, that had nothing to do with it. But good that you
interpreted it that way, right?
Yeah. Assumed that. And there's a really great bit of animation, which I notice every time in this episode, and I love it, when Leela finally wakes up and Fry's there, and there is the one-eye squeaky thing. There is the jacket on her.
On her, yeah.
But on the television as well, the monitor, there is the ice fields, which is the last planet.
Of Hyperia.
Which, the thing is, everything... And every time I watch this episode, I always really pay attention to Fry's dialogue after he dies. Because there are some lines that he speaks at Leela, but they have nothing to do with her response. One of the last ones is like, Leela, you need to wake up. And it's like, I'm scared. And it's like, the Leela I know is stronger than this. It's like, that could be taken as a response.
But it's just what he's saying to her.
Just him pleading with her. And it gets me every
good
time.
Writing.
It's such a powerful line. And Billy West does a great job in delivering. It's just the simplicity and the style every time he just says of, I need you to wake up, is so...
It's
brilliant.
Very underplayed.
It's
just...
so truthful and it's lovely. There is so much heart in this episode.
The writers did try very hard to make every piece of dialogue that Fry says contextually can work outside of her dream. they admit that not all of it does.
There is about three lines.
Yeah, but they tried for the most part too, so that you could draw that conclusion.
And to begin with, at the beginning of the episode, you don't really pick up on it because some of the lines do respond.
Yes.
They clearly respond. But then there are some lines which are just Fry talking. And even the simplicity in the animation when Leela's asleep and you see Fry's hair and mouth show up. And it's like, Leela, I'm talking at you, just in case, like, because even if you can't hear me.
Yeah, he's saying, if you can't hear me, I'm just going to talk.
Yeah. And then he forms. So, like, obviously, when, like, there must be some response in the machine that Leela, like, her heart rate goes up or something. And he's like, Leela! And it's like, okay, cool.
Yeah, he's got a feedback, so he stops going blah, 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 and actually speaks.
Which is beautiful. It's also, Leela is responsible for this.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
Yes, because she took foolishly a fucking takes the
bee
queen
onto the ship.
This is maybe one small problem I have about this is I don't think they give her a reasoning, right? Is that they can raise their own hive and make their own honey. Yes, not have to do this again.
Which is an opportunity. It's a strong opportunity.
Sort of, I don't think it fits that well with her character. I don't think she would be
happy.
She's not impulsive. It's part of her character they riff on quite often, right? They focus heavily on it in one of the Anthology of Interest.
Yes, yeah.
Where they go, she's like, what if I was more impulsive? Just a tiny bit more impulsive, right? And it's such a rash thing to do.
I guess it also stems from that thing of she is very much like, we're better than the old crew. We can do all this.
Yeah, there's that overrides it. So it does make sense to a degree.
Also, even finding the previous crew in the black box, and I love the fact it's like Farnsworth has so many, like, reverse psychology of, like, getting people to do the job because he's like, you're not good enough. And it's like, we're better than them. And then
you just know he's there at Hermes before he goes into that room and goes, right. So we're just going to use the reverse psychology and we'll get them to do
just tell them that they suck. Fry is super happy about sucking.
Yeah. Also, Leela, in her strength to prove that she's better than the previous crew, very much will throw Bender under the bus, which is lovely.
Oh, they're just, good luck!
That, to me, was one of my favourite lines just because I'm like, Bender has thrown you guys under the bus so many times.
Just leave him.
Fuck, he can breathe in space. It's fine.
Yeah.
Really good animation.
It's poison.
No, yeah. The deterioration of Fry in this as well. Like, if you look at his animation before the stinger, when they get out and Leela's like, okay, cool, everything's fine. And Fry looks matted and he's just like, Leela, I need you to look after yourself because he is genuinely concerned. Because Leela is going gung-ho in the sense of, I will prove the professor wrong. And Fry's like
we almost died.
Yeah, and Fry's like, you will die and I don't want you to die. As we've seen before, Fry will gladly sacrifice himself for Leela, but he doesn't want Leela to die, even throwing himself in front of the stinger, which the justification there... Side note, I did an improv scene once where I threw myself on a grenade, someone else threw themselves on top of me, and it blew up, and I survived somehow because the explosion went through me. So that joke of the stinger...
Makes sense, yeah.
Because the person on top of me died. So I'm like... He stopped moving, so I'm like, oh, I guess I'm alive then. So that stinger joke just is such a good payoff. Like, I love that.
Just because of your specific experience with an improv scene.
I love that joke the first time I saw it as well, because I'm like, oh yeah, that totally makes sense. The stinger went completely through, so...
Well, I guess the poison pumps out of the tip, right?
Yes, absolutely.
I also like, as an initial thing, they were looking at the authenticity of the episode, and they looked at the idea of royal honey, which is the thing.
Oh yeah, royal jelly, yeah.
Yes.
However, royal honey is actually creamy white. Yes, royal jelly is creamy white,
which is creepy looking.
Which is creepy looking and like doesn't play as well in animation, so they've decided against that.
Yeah. Here's a river of stuff that looks like semen.
Fry will fall into.
Yeah. Well, they have the whole pseudoscience explanation for him coming back inside Leela's dream.
Yes.
Which is like entirely internally consistent for Futurama.
Yes.
So, oh, he there was an imprint of his DNA in the jelly.
And brainwaves.
And blood.
And brainwaves, right? Yeah. But what I was kind of waiting for in that scene was them to maybe play up the idea. It's like, oh, I'm so glad you're not dead. And be like, well, the old Fry is dead.
Yeah.
I am actually dead. This is a replacement me.
Yes.
And the kind of...
I am a clone, essentially.
Yeah, the kind of jet black humor of that would have been really nice.
The real world would have had that. Like, if it was, but the fact that it was a dream, it was the most perfect scenario for Leela. Which is Fry is fine and there's no consequences.
Yeah. Let's go with this. Negatives for the episode.
Oh, I really wanted to... I hadn't finished on my positives. Yeah.
Oh, well, we can end with positives.
Okay.
Yeah, it's a shit sandwich. You have something good, you have something terrible, you have something good.
Yeah. So what is terrible? Well, not terrible. What is negative about this episode?
I think... Someone else go first. I'm struggling to think of negatives for this episode, honestly.
I am too. I want to be fair.
We need to be fair.
So they maybe the opening scene isn't the strongest, and there's a couple of weird jokes with yes, yes, yes. No, no, no.
Oh, yeah, I didn't enjoy
that's
that.
That's an American breakfast cereal.
Yes, I know it's a reference to something.
That's a negative. That's a good negative. That
just went straight over my head and was a little contrived.
Even when when they find the beehive and Leela's like, "We're here, the honeycomb hideout." I'm like, "That's a reference to something," and I don't like it.
Or just it's just a bad line, yes. Right?
Yeah.
There's a few little duff lines here. And there.
I have noticed that a few of the, you know, whether it's a result of the writing or just the voice actors or a combination of both, sometimes they just can't handle certain pop culture reference lines.
Yeah.
It feels very contrived.
Pop culture is very hard to do it authentically.
Well, sometimes they do.
Not just for Futurama, but in general.
Yeah. On that note, I do... You probably heard me in the episode where I went, oh, that was subtle, where they do the 2001 Space Odyssey, and you're like, it is like, they just literally put the Star Child scene on the screen.
Yes.
With the... You know, the two planes rushing towards her and her eye changing colour. It's like, that's not a clever reference. That's just copying it. And I felt like that was a little bit just sort of like, hey, you guys have seen 2001. It felt a bit empty.
Yeah. For some reason, I remember that scene being that she opens it up, she sees herself and she wakes up. For some reason, that's how I remember that scene going, which I think is better. Like, the idea of opening the coffin and it being empty. Or
being you.
Or you're mad, you're dead.
Opening it to see Leela opening it on the other side.
Yeah,
so
that
it's like the
cool,
idea of like... because it is too on the nose.
Yeah.
Right. I mean, it doesn't they've done that in Futurama before. Fear of a Bot Planet, which is still notoriously Baby Beard's... one of their most hated episodes so far. With myself, Chris and James, noticed there was a Tetris... little gag, which is basically they drag one of the blocks on top of blocks and it ruins the whole thing.
I'll tell you right now, that's one of the three scenes I remember from that episode.
Yeah, and we just went, why is it there? What's it doing?
Yeah.
What's the context?
You know Tetris, so do we.
Yeah.
And it just doesn't really add anything.
I think they did that just to show that it was not complete madness, it was more the fact that the world wasn't truly the world of that, but which again, they could have done it so much better.
I mean, the musical number is so much more creative.
Oh, good.
Yes.
So much more creative.
Even that cute bee.
Yeah.
And the gruesomeness of them all expanding and exploding.
And then you just snap back into reality straight up. Oh, there's good gravity. I tried.
Yeah.
I tried to make it happen. I tried so hard.
Fantastic transition. Even in Leela's mind, Zoidberg is the showman. He's the biggest showman.
He has a great Zoidberg and lights behind him. Oh, I love that.
That was good. That was lovely. So
and to me, that just, once again, to me, the sound and the music to this is just expertly done.
Yeah.
I'm actually surprised because I think they have been nominated for sound design before.
Mm.
I just really felt this. My focus was drawn to it.
The bee design in this as well is fantastic.
Yeah.
The bees look cool and terrifying.
Both cool, menacing, and cute.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Especially the cute baby queen. Like, when she's, like, rolled up, you're like, that is...
It's the eyes as well.
It's genuinely cute.
Yeah.
Have you seen, like, close-ups of bees?
They're pretty terrifying.
I love
it. I don't like getting close to them.
I love bees. They're so adorable. They're, like, big, fluffy, multi-legged dogs.
I'm actually really glad this episode wasn't wasps.
Yes.
I have what's called Spheksophobia.
Oh.
Fear of wasps?
Fear of wasps.
But you don't have fear of bees?
No.
Really?
I have a somewhat traumatic experience with wasps. Where
you have a history.
I got stung under the eye and it swelled up so much that my eye swelled shut for a day or two.
Yeah, that
became Leela.
I got really, really scared of wasps.
Totally understand. Like,
bees just do not do it in the same way to me. They're not scary to me, but wasps, I have a really visceral reaction.
Depictions
of wasps.
So you have
one of the hallmarks.
Chris has spider arachnophobia.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
What about you, Josh?
You have any hang-ups?
I have a fear that a startled bird will fly and peck me in the eye.
Is that a legitimate?
It is legitimately my fear. I don't know if it's got a phobia attached to it.
Right.
Birds are pretty scary.
Bird of phobia.
Well, not birds. Birds are fine, but like a bird getting startled and pecking me in the eye.
So bird with intention.
birds with intention to murder. It's funny though, because bees have the common decency to die after they sting you, whereas a wasp...
Not always, apparently.
Really?
Yeah. So apparently if you leave them, they can unwind themselves and fly away. But you have to endure a wasp, a bee being stuck in your,
I do know that bees that get drunk and come back to the hive have their wings torn off by the bouncers.
Yes, they do. Because they get drunk on fermented sap.
Yes. Yeah. And fruit as well.
And fruit as well.
Yeah. Jesus.
Yeah. There'll be two guard bees who are basically the door bees that'll be like, oh, you're drunk, taking your wings, you're going home, mate. And they just, they're not killed. Just their wings are torn off.
I've heard that sometimes that if they come back too many times, they will be bitten in half.
Yeah.
They just go, nah.
Yeah. Bees need to chill out.
Well, they've got a hive to run, man.
I don't have mentality. Just,
you know what? They need a union.
Yeah, bee union.
Union. Isn't that what the Jerry Seinfeld movie's about?
I have not seen that, and I refuse to.
Yeah. I've seen the YouTube
video.
You like
jazz?
Which
like
is
jazz?
Every time someone says bee.
Yeah, it gets,
bee movie,
it gets
but
faster.
It gets faster.
Yes.
Yeah. I've seen that, not the actual movie.
Yeah. But yeah, just one thing I will note very quickly is this episode was brought about by one simple question that Eric Kaplan, the writer, first came up with, which is, what if we killed off a character?
Right, yeah.
And what a good choice of character to kill off.
Yeah, the...
And a nice way of handling it. I know it's a cliche to say it's all a dream.
Yeah.
But
it's more than that.
It is, because it is a layered kind of dream thing, where she is falling asleep within her own dream and trying to work. And that makes it sort of a bit more sophisticated than everything happens as normal. And then at the end, whoa, it was all a dream. It's got more of a what is happening.
Dream.
Explore the kind of dreamscape.
But even with that dream, you are progressing one of the fundamental themes of the entire series, which is Fry and Leela's relationship.
Yes.
Yeah. You still progress that.
Even like, I think it's the sweetest line in this entire episode. And it's not when Fry says that he loves Leela, which is such a good line as well. It's like the credit scene where Leela just goes, you need a shower. And Fry says, so do you.
Yeah.
And it's just like, that is so sweet.
Which was put in at the last moment.
It's sweet. It's wonderful.
It was just meant to be silence.
It's beautiful.
It's nice.
It's beautiful. I think it's better than silence.
It doesn't undercut the scene.
Yeah.
No,
it's funny, but it doesn't undercut the scene.
It also shows that their relationship is stronger than just like a standard television, like, will they, won't they relationship of like, oh, they love each other. It's like, no, these people actually genuinely care about each other to the degree that it's like, I'm going to tell you that you stink.
Yes.
And you're going, and you'll be okay with it because it's not an insult. You stink.
It's something about the way she says when she comes up to the 2001 coffin and she says, you know, I'm going to find my friend, you know, and the way she delivers that line of talking about her friendship with Fry.
Yeah.
And sure, there's romance, there's the field, the sleigh ride on the fields of Hyperion.
Yeah.
But with really, this episode is about the depth of their relationship outside of
how
romance.
How far they've come.
Yeah.
There's even a simple bit of animation when they're dancing on Venus. Was it Venus?
Let's say yes.
Yes. Yeah. Gardens of Venus.
When
Venusian Gardens.
When Fry lowers Leela, Leela's leg is up. Like, she's
it's quite
into
feminine.
The dance. Yeah, she's into the dance.
Yeah.
Because that's not like having done ballroom, you don't put your leg up if you're like, I really feel uncomfortable in this dance.
Yes.
It's like, I feel like my partner has me and I feel like my partner is not going to drop me. It's
trust.
Yeah, absolutely trust. It's gorgeous.
We've actually had our legs up for the entirety of this episode, showing that we love it so much.
I've got to touch on something we haven't talked about before, and a bit of a running theme for me in this podcast. I love the professor in this episode.
Yes, you're so good.
My favorite, if I was to pick one moment, would be I made myself sad. just lovely.
Mine is that he was going to guillotine Leela.
Oh, yes. Oh. And then she says, can't you scan my brain without cutting my head off? Yes,
well, yes, of course I can.
Easily. Which, not just yes, of course. Yes, easily.
Which shows Leela's subconscious perception of the professor.
Yes.
He will make a complicated solution that will endanger someone rather than the simple solution that is also available.
Accurate.
And I also love that it's in keeping with the fact that Farnsworth just wants to harvest everything about Leela. Wants her organs, wants her brain, just needs a body, a cadaver to work on.
Yeah, he really does just need death around him to work on.
And one last thing from me.
Yes.
When they chuck the baby queen out of the airlock.
Oh.
And he gets hit by a passing truck. In all of space.
Yeah.
Just a lovely timing. Timing in that moment is perfect.
Yeah, absolutely.
Just spot on.
I think that this grief, loss, and... guilt, grief slash loss, and madness, this episode just knocks it out of the park.
Mm,
so much heart and
so
creepiness.
What?
Creepiness.
And just a really good exploration of Leela.
Yes.
Her character.
And not just Leela, but Leela's own feelings for Fry. what Fry truly means to Leela.
Mm.
Also, welcome back, Professor Farnsworth.
Yeah.
We missed you.
Missed you last week.
Yeah. He was prepping,
and the week before that.
He was prepping this dangerous mission.
That's what he was doing.
Oh, Hermes was good in this episode as well. And Amy had some good lines as well.
Everyone was pretty on point.
Yeah, that was. I think it was really well written for everyone.
So, ladies and gentlemen, we have a bit of a vote to get to.
Yes.
Which pits...
I'm not going first this week. Pardon? I'm not going first this week.
I will.
I was going to go first.
Well,
I am Spartacus.
Go on, Josh.
Okay, Spartacus.
Jurassic Bark versus The Sting.
These are two episodes with heart. These are two episodes with sci-fi elements. I am absolutely voting for The Sting, though. Mm-hmm. I'm not surprised,
given how you were like, this is the best episode. Yes, it's the best episode.
Yeah, it's... The animation, it's one of those rare times as well where every single character has either some good dialogue, great dialogue, or good character design.
Mm.
Even the simplicity of Zoidberg, like raising his
tentacles
to like
1, 2, 3.
Yeah. Amy being there as a supportive friend, Hermes being there as simultaneously mourning and like burning his time card as well. Like just these like little things that happen with these characters add so much weight to them.
Mm.
But then you get to the real heart of the matter of Leela is dealing with everything at once, and her brain is quite literally on fire from the poison of a giant bee. But through all that, she has some clarity that she needs to make. She needs to make everything right. She needs to survive, and she needs to make sure that whatever her and Fry are together exists and continues. And this is not about romantic love. This is not about the love of friendship. This is like pure and simple love and trying to fix the universe, which is very Leela. And I think the heart here is more than for a man and his dog. I think this is a love of a world together. Mm. So I'm going for The Sting.
Oh, do I have to go next?
Yeah.
Jesus.
I know, it's tough, isn't
it? They stand side by side for me.
Mm.
Because they have a similar tone.
Yep.
Both
are about loss.
I have this weird weight of expectation, I feel like, of the Futurama fandom holding Jurassic Bark so highly.
Yes, yes.
And I feel like, would it be wrong of me in the face of that popular opinion to say that this is a better episode?
Mm. Come down to what you think.
Yeah, that's what I'm trying to do. Yeah. I'm trying to separate in my mind
they don't
the
exist.
Reverence they have. They
it's just us in this room.
It's you in a room.
Yes. I think what tipped me over was you saying that what's better about this episode is that it's about Fry and Leela together. It's not just about Fry and his relationship to the past.
Yes.
And his letting go of his previous life.
Mm.
It's about two characters moving forward into their relationship now.
Yeah.
And for me that is more rewarding than a heart-wrenching look at a past companion from Fry's life.
Ending happily as well, rather than ending with the idea of
utter devastation.
Despair.
Yeah. Yeah. So I think it edges out for me. I think it's millimeters.
Yeah.
You know, if you could.
It's a photo finish.
Oh, it's a quantum finish.
Yeah, exactly.
I think this episode has it for me. Just ever so slightly. And the other thing I think that might tip it over is the joy in the animation.
Yes.
And the way that the opening, the bees are realised, and the
not
hive
the
is realised. Not the bees. No. And the later on, the ever disintegrating dream sequences are realised. Mm. Lots of creativity there, which I applaud. Super great.
Another strong theme that keeps these episodes together is Farnsworth just fucking with everything.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I haven't been shy about the fact that I did not think Jurassic Bark was going to be the top of the season.
Yeah.
Mm. I've been actively looking for an episode that I thought might progress further. As I said, I was really worried about The Sting because I've been looking forward to this episode since. Because
and we've been burned in the past, right?
Hello, Amazon remember. Women in the
Mood. Yeah.
And I was worried that this wasn't going to hold up as my favourite episode because as a kid, I remember this holding the most... occupied the most space in my heart.
Yeah, what a kid's know.
Yeah, right?
It resonated the most with you.
This is one of two episodes in Futurama that has actually hit me in the heart and gave me that pang of despair, which the first was Luck of the Friarish. And the second was this episode, and it's when it's kind of at the culmination of the episode, which is when he's saying wake up, and it just hits me. It hit me in our second viewing as well, which is really telling. So besides everything that's already been said, is that I find this it fires on all cylinders.
Yeah,
for what do I call it now? The Disney patented.
It's the profit.
Everything's owned by Disney now.
It's the profit of Sean's triad of a Futurama episode.
Yeah, look, it's got the fantastic sci-fi element. We're looking at dreamscape and sequences
and space bees.
And it's absolutely, in my mind, hilarious, especially the first 10... Kind of the first half of the episode is where you get a lot of the hilarity, and the second half is where you really kick in the emotional resonancy.
It grabs you, and then it takes you down with it. And you go, Billy West and Katie Sagal do a fantastic job in this episode as well.
Absolutely.
Hats off to both of them.
It just... Jurassic Park just did not hit me as much as it does, apparently, every other Futurama fan.
I think that one hits people a lot harder as well when they have a strong connection to a pet.
I do, though. I do.
You see, I don't really. So I still...
Me too. I feel the same way. I think you might be onto something.
Yeah, I still think...
You're just an outlier.
Yeah.
I've got my buddy Bailey at home.
You don't live with that pet, you know.
But every time I'm there, I melt. Yeah. Right. Okay. Absolutely melt.
Have you experienced any significant loss with a pet?
Oh,
though?
Yes. Several times over.
Okay, then you are absolutely the outlier.
Yeah, I'm just dead inside.
That's right. I've experienced so much, personal loss of people, but I've never experienced the personal loss of a pet. Personally, my parents' pet dogs were put down when I was very young.
Companion animal.
German Shepherd, and I forget the other one, but I was apparently very close to them up to the age of 4, but I still don't have that strong memory. But this is...
Yeah. So basically what we're saying is, apologies, Ellen.
Yes.
But The Sting unanimously charges forth as the current season 4 winner.
And fantastic. Ellen, I want to know what your thoughts are as well. And
Ellen?
Ellen?
Ellen? Ellen?
Are you in the room with us now? We're about to do a conjuring scene where we're all going to close the circle. Or it could be Conjuring 2, that guy with the dice.
Yeah.
That was a terrible film.
So, ladies and gentlemen, if you would like to...
We need to do a voice.
If you would like to wait for a moment while we talk about the voice.
There is... Or the bees.
I was going to suggest the bees.
The bees. No, you have to do a specific line.
I did.
I just heard a jumbled mess.
No.
Which line was that?
That was Bender saying... yeah, exactly. That.
Okay.
You suck.
I'll give you
Bender's great. Deal with it.
That's the one.
Duh.
How's the abdomen?
Yeah.
Swollen with jelly, I assume.
He insulted our fat queen.
yes, we go. Of course. How would you not get that?
Oh, that's I think one negative that I'll just add quickly at the end of it. That joke about the try having 10,000 children.
I didn't enjoy that joke either.
Yeah, it's a bit mean. Mean spirited. Yeah.
A little bit. Although I do love just Fatso over there. It's just calling the Queen Fat is so Bender.
babybeardmedia@gmail.com.
At babybeardmedia on social media.
I just need you to wake up. And give us 5 stars!
On iTunes. Do it on iTunes.
And if you want to communicate with us in non-bee form, listen to a previous episode and get all the emails and everything, because I don't know them, because that's not my job! I'm in charge of the shining sword of approval and stars.
So!
I just need you to wake up.
I'm
so much fun.
What I'd like you all to do is to fall asleep as soon as this episode finishes and wake up exactly 7 days from now and join us for Bend Her.
Is that a Ben-Hur riff, I hear?
Maybe.
Also, might just be adding the letter H into Bender's name, because he does some things, or should I say, they do some things.
What does that mean? You should probably know.
Roberto and Flexo and every other robot ever comes back.
And until that time, I have been Buzzing Sean.
I've been swollen with royal jelly. Phil.
And I've been here with you the entire time, Josh. When I was a kid, I watched the Lindsay Lohan Parent Trap like every day for like 2 weeks in a school holiday.
Oh my god.
I'd watch it in the morning when I was eating breakfast.
That's crazy. Kids are weird.
I like Lindsay Lohan and I like that film.
As a diversion.
As a diversion.
Oh, I see what she's done.
I love
taken a barnacle.
He's great.
And painted it in bioluminescent algae as a diversion.
Pick one. Just pick one.
Getting right up near people as well. Just being like slowly moving like this all in black cloak and everything. And just be like, and then run after something else. Like, yeah.
Well, people probably don't. They probably imagine that we have like conversations outside of the podcast. It's not true. Yeah. We actually sit in silence.
Yeah,
the moment until the podcast starts.
Yeah, the moment that we turn this off, we just all look at each other, nod, and walk away.
Yeah, that's right.
We just got to say, outside of this, we just don't exist.
Yeah. Oh yeah, that's me.